So tonight we've got Dr. Anita Lee. She's a staff specialist at the Royal Adelaide Hospital. She's a rheumatologist, also in private work at Wakefield House. She has a particular interest in early arthritis and helps run a early arthritis clinic at the Royal Adelaide. She did a thesis and practices in musculoskeletal ultrasound, and I'm trying to tee her up to teach me where the on switches are mine. So those are her interests, and she's been particularly wonderful tonight by me asking her and agreeing to talk about rheumatological masquerades of sports medicine. This has probably come from a couple of things I saw with young fellas with sore backs and a couple of swollen joints that the physios weren't having too much luck with. So luckily I was able to think of a couple of blood tests and then send them on to the right people. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Anita. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Mark. Can everybody hear me?
Yes, Anita.
Okay, great. All right, now... Just trying to work out how my slides work, and then we can do some. Oops, that's better.
Yeah, it's up and down. Well,
I can probably just do this now.
Yeah.
Yep. Okay. So basically, what I want to do tonight is to have a bit of a discussion with those who are on the line to try and recognise conditions that do masquerade as a sporting injury that might be rheumatological in origin. To know how to diagnose them, investigate and manage them as well. So I've got four cases that I want to chat about, and also we need to work out when they might be useful to refer them to a rheumatologist. Can I just go down?
Yeah, try that.
Alright, so case number one, and stop me anytime you want if you want to ask any questions, please. So I've got a 32-year-old lady who plays Div 1 club tennis. She 6 months ago had a swollen right knee that actually got better after 2 weeks of naproxen and putting a brace on her knee. Unfortunately now that swollen right knee has come back, and she's had some physio for it, but it's not really getting any better. And she's noticed that it's actually become swollen again. She doesn't recall actually hurting it when she's been playing tennis, but she does volunteer that she is a bit stiff for about an hour in the morning, and she can wake up at night time with the pain in the right knee. She hasn't described being unwell prior to this happening, and she doesn't really smoke or drink very much. This is a picture of the right knee, which you can see is swollen compared to the left knee. So I was just wondering if people had other questions they wanted to ask, other examination findings they wanted to know, and then based on those, investigations that you might want to order, what the differentials might be at this point in time, and then treatment. So I'll open it to anybody that wants to ask a question or comment.
Right, so Graham, I know you, unfortunately, so what do you reckon?
So she was quite well before all of this started, so she didn't feel like she had any, you know, viral illness. She hasn't had any fever, she's not been, you know, nauseated or vomiting. The joint itself is swollen and warm, but it's not red and hot, so it's not looking like it's a septic arthritis anyway.
When you look at the joint, is it a localised swelling as you might find with the first time, or is it the whole?
It seems like in that picture, so it seems like the whole knee appears swollen, but she's got a positive patella tap, so she's got a you know, moderate size effusion at least. Yeah.
You know, I can't see the pictures, I can't see
the. Oh, you don't have the slides that you can see?
No.
Oh,
okay.
Have you... Okay, we'll just, we'll have a chat about what we need down the track for the... Did you download any software to your computer, John?
No, I don't know.
Oh, that's all right. Well, we'll...
People
That's okay. Well, we'll talk about it later. But the picture sort of basically showed a young woman's legs with quite a swollen, diffusely swollen sort of right knee that on the picture anyway didn't look like it was wildly red. But was it red?
No. So it's just it's swollen and it's a bit warm and tender, but it's certainly not septic arthritis looking anyway. Any other questions? Otherwise, I can give a bit of further history.
One. Where you go?
I was just wondering about, you know, other joints, other illnesses, whether it was just an isolated knee or whether she was having issues in other areas of the body.
Yeah, very good question. So, in fact, when you ask her this, she has had for the last 6 weeks some difficulty turning on her on and off her taps and opening up jars. Her hands seem to be not working as well. And she feels like, a truck's run over her. She really is very tired, but she does say she's got a 5-year-old and a 3-year-old. So she thinks it's just because they don't really sleep well that she's just, particularly tired. But she does, feel tired all the time, more so than usual.
Generally with medical-type joint conditions, oftentimes they will give you a lot of sleep disturbance. So first time you've got disturbed sleep because the children are only 30, and it's a sleep disturbance because of the aching joints and discomfort of the night.
Yeah, that's exactly what I'm trying to say here, because people often will, put down something to, their kids or something else happening, but she is waking up at night time with joint pain, so it does sound inflammatory. There's no other autoimmune symptoms, so she hasn't got any mouth ulcers or alopecia, Raynaud's, if you're thinking of other autoimmune causes. And there certainly wasn't any rash and there wasn't any other infection or virus before this.
And has she had any gastrointestinal symptoms, any sort of diarrhoea? Or?
So no gastro, no diarrhoea. So what are you thinking of, Mark?
Intrahepatic sort of arthropathies, mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that's a good thought because it's, single lower limb joint swollen, yeah.
And no STDs or history of pelvic inflammatory disease?
Not that she knows of. She's not symptomatic of any.
Yep. Very good.
Okay, so when we examine her, she in fact does have several MCP joints that are swollen on both.
Hello, do we have someone else just joined us a few seconds ago?
Hello.
Hello, yep, Mark Rafe here, how are you? We may have, but it's good. We're just more the merrier. Just listening to Anita go through, Anita Lee, rheumatologist, just go through a first case of a 32-year-old female with just presenting with a one-off swollen red knee, or swollen knee, sorry, not red, and we're just going through the further examination.
Yeah, so at the moment, when you examine her, she has got a couple of MCP joints that are swollen as well bilaterally. She had actually just said that she was having some trouble opening taps and jars and things like that. She certainly has a swollen right knee. It's not red or hot. It is tender. There's a small effusion there with a positive patella tap. Her right wrist was also tender when you pushed it, but wasn't swollen. There wasn't any rash to see. There was no psoriasis, no psoriatic nail changes, no rheumatoid nodules, no gouty tophi that you could see. So, investigations that people might want to do at this point?
I guess you've really got to look at bloods, haven't you?
So what would you like to know?
Well, I guess white cell count, hemoglobin, full blood count.
Mm-hmm.
I think as Brian mentioned, CRP, PSR, I think that's still done.
Yeah. Okay, so...
Yeah, the rheumatological condition, I could get mixed up with rheumatoid manager, ANA, and so on, so I might take some assistance there.
Okay.
But I guess also do we need to look at past history of events, things like Rust River fever and whatnot.
Okay, very good, yep. So they're all really good suggestions. And certainly so she's had a full blood picture. In fact, it was normal, so she's certainly not anemic to make her tired. I might just move the page up. So she does have a raised ESR and CRP, so ESR is 52, CRP is 18. She's rheumatoid factor negative, but she's CCP highly positive, so greater than 100.
Which one was that?
So CCP, the cyclic citrullinated peptide, was greater than 100. So that's fairly specific.
Well, and while we're on there, just in case people haven't used CCP, do you use it all the time with when you're testing, you know, your rheumatoid factor is one that's been around for ages, but has it been superseded or would you always use rheumatoid factor and CCP?
We still always do rheumatoid factor because that's what we call seropositive rheumatoid arthritis if the rheumatoid factor is positive.
Mm-hmm.
If it's negative, it's useful in particular to have a CCP. We do the CCP with the rheumatoid factor all the time, really because it's a good prognostic indicator. So if you're CCP positive, apart from it being quite specific for rheumatoid arthritis, you may have a worse prognosis in terms of... you know, less likely to go into remission, more joint damage, erosive disease.
Mm.
It's quite important to know if you're CCP positive for a prognostic sort of point of view.
Okay.
Yeah. So she's also had viral screens, and someone mentioned Ross River virus. So she's had parvovirus, Ross River done. They were both negative. She's had hepatitis B, C, HIV, which we do in everybody with polyarthritis, and they were all negative. She's had an ANA done. That was also mentioned, and that was negative. And she just happens also to be vitamin D deficient. So her vitamin D is 25. She's also had other viruses done that we tend to do, like Barmer Forest virus and chikungunya virus. So
what's that one?
Chikungunya.
Chikungunya.
So nothing is that to do going with around? Chickens. there are some cases in Australia. There were sort of big outbreaks in 2007 or so in India and. More recently, there have been other outbreaks and people have now been tested positive for chikungunya virus in the USA and Europe, and there's been a couple of cases in Australia. So mosquito-borne virus, so a bit like the same mosquito as dengue fever,
okay.
But very severe joint pains, usually with fever, rash.
Chikungunya.
Chikungunya, yeah. So not quite spelt like chicken.
Is that a little bit climate dependent as well? Because some of these viral things tend to come down at various times of the year.
Yeah, I mean, I think you don't really have to have that sort of travel history because the mosquitoes are pretty much everywhere. And the Aedes aegypti mosquito is the one that usually will cause chikungunya. So it's the same one that can cause dengue fever. Basically if you've got a very sort of severe onset arthritis and you also happen to have a fever, a rash, and you just, you know, general malaise and really not well, you've obviously got to exclude other viral causes as well. But, you know, treatment is really only symptomatic for chikungunya. So, you know, analgesics, anti-inflammatories, things for the fever and so on, but it usually will be eventually hopefully self-limiting. But quite severe arthritis at the beginning, which can look like rheumatoid.
So how long does the measurement take?
Well, probably months, I would say. They should get better. Yeah. Well, probably a couple of months, I would say. We haven't actually seen any cases of chikungunya in our clinic so far. We've tested, you know, probably for the last year or two on everybody that's come with a new polyarthritis, and we haven't had any positives in Adelaide anyway so far.
Very good. We'll push on with the other one.
Yep. So then they've had some x-rays done, which we still tend to do, and there are no erosions in the hands or feet. We've x-rayed both of those. And the right knee on plain x-ray also looks normal. What else could we do at this point in time?
Yep. Well, you've got x-rays. Is there I'm still a bit puzzled as to the usefulness of ultrasounds for knees with fusions.
Okay. Well, I mean, effusions are usually quite easy to detect clinically, but you can pick up smaller effusions on ultrasound that you can't pick up on clinical examination. I don't think ultrasound of the knee is as useful as, for example, ultrasound of the hands and feet, where you can show subclinical synovitis and early erosion. So you may pick up erosions on ultrasound, so 6 to 7 times more than on plain x-ray. So very good for sort of early diagnosis when you are suspicious of something going on there. If your x-rays are normal, which they likely will be early on, then ultrasound can be quite useful.
From a sports medicine perspective, the ultrasound I tend to use, and I think this is the Medicare rebatable issues, medial collateral ligament Baker's cyst, any meniscal cyst. Hoffa's fat pad can show up quite bright, so anterior impingement, and of course patella sort of tendon disease, tendinopathies. Of course, it can sometimes, if there's a really big lateral or peripheral tear, sometimes I can see that on ultrasound, but it's really not obviously for meniscal issues. So you have to be a little bit careful. Basically, from a sports medicine point of view, unless it's I've got an ultrasound which I was chatting to Anita about before, and I found it's quite good for picking up perhaps more fluid in the knee than I'd expect clinically. And the other thing I use it for a lot is actually then getting some fluid out and getting it under the microscope. So it's in the suprapatellar pouch, you know, if there's a small effusion, I found that the ultrasound's pretty good at getting that stuff out. So from my point of view, Anita, that might be something that could be useful, to getting some knee fluid out to see if there's a crystal arthropathy.
Yeah. I mean, I think personally, as a rheumatologist, you would just do it clinically.
Okay.
So it's pretty easy to do. If you're having trouble, then you could use ultrasound guidance, but we generally don't need to.
Just for interest,
yeah.
What portal do you use to get into the knee?
Clinically,
yeah.
We go medially.
Yep.
Yeah.
Under the patella?
Under the patella, yeah. I mean, suprapatellar pouch will show up on ultrasound and show up fluid easier. So if I was to use ultrasound to aspirate, I would aspirate from the pouch.
Yeah.
Okay, so has anyone got a diagnosis at this point after that information? So CCP highly positive, RF negative, raised inflammatory markers, single joint swollen, but a bit of MCP joint swelling as well of the hands in a young lady.
Yes, all right. If you've got the slides up, you might be at a slight advantage. Anyway, those things that are on the slide Anita can go through.
Yeah,
right?
Sure. Well, I mean, we call it seronegative because a rheumatoid factor is negative. So it's by definition. Her serology is negative, but she's CCP positive. And I think you could actually diagnose her with the time she's given, the time frame. So it had started 6 months ago in the knee already, and it had come back recently, but the six-week history in the hand. So she's got a long enough history to suggest it may well be rheumatoid arthritis. So you've got the very highly positive CCP, which is very specific, over 95% specific for rheumatoid arthritis. If you were thinking about lupus, because she's a young lady, we had mentioned she hadn't had any autoimmune features. So, and her ANA being negative, you know, makes it much less likely. You could be thinking about psoriatic arthritis as well. So the nails were normal. There was no psoriasis, and she's highly CCP positive. So very few false positive CCPs, just, you know, in psoriatic arthritis. We've seen a few, but very, very rarely. Post-viral, certainly possible, but her pattern of disease seems to be increasing rather than a decrescendo pattern you'd expect in viral arthritis. So if this was, say, parvovirus polyarthritis, she should be getting better after a couple of months, but she's actually getting worse. Mark mentioned about aspirating the knee. So someone had mentioned earlier about septic arthritis. So obviously it's very important if you think the knee is red and hot to aspirate to make sure it isn't infected. And also to look for crystals at the same time for gout or pseudo-gout.
If she was septic, would the CRP be higher?
You would think so, yeah. I mean, you would probably be in the hundreds, but yeah, her CRP is fairly, benign, I suppose. So that was, it was 18 or something, wasn't it? So you would think that, and I said that she hadn't had a white cell count or a fever, so it didn't sound like she had septic arthritis anyway. And it really wasn't a sort of red hot gouty looking joint, and it's not really sounding like that from her history, being a 32-year-old lady with her other history that we've given you. So I think we are reasonably happy at this point in time with the tests and what we found clinically to call her rheumatoid arthritis. Is everyone happy with that, or are there other differentials that people wanted to consider?
Can I mention one question? Can you have
So her vitamin D level was 25, so quite low. So there is some deficiency there. So why do you ask about vitamin D?
Well, I guess when you're looking at a rheumatological issue,
I might have a quick chat about vitamin D later, but it's definitely important in autoimmune disease in both triggering it and also maybe, being able to reduce flares if you treat the vitamin D deficiency, but that's not so clear But certainly we do test for vitamin D levels.
Hi, may I know if paraneoplastic syndromes present similarly?
Sorry, what was that again, sir?
Yeah, I was wondering if paraneoplastic syndromes can present similarly with polyarthritis in a young lady.
Yeah, I mean, I think you'd have to have the other history that, you know, if she was particularly unwell or losing weight or other things. And she really, as I was mentioning, apart from feeling a bit tired, she's actually really been quite well in herself. And I would think that you would think about it, paraneoplasty, but it's really not that common. And certainly rheumatoid is a lot more common than, you know, paraneoplastic polyarthritis.
Right, okay, thank you.
No worries. All right, so I reckon we should move to management. So what do people generally tend to do? So if this person's presented to one of you in your practice, and you know they're going to have to wait to see a rheumatologist, what are you going to do for them?
Most likely consider steroids, I would suppose.
So what sort of steroids? So oral or into the joint? Or?
Well, I'd probably use oral, I think.
And what sort of doses would you use?
There'd be benefit with the steroid, but she's got other symptoms as well, and she might feel generally better overall if she had some oral steroids.
Mm-hmm. What sort of doses would you use?
Look, I'll take a punt. I'd probably use maybe 50 milligrams for a few days and probably settle with 25 milligrams, but I'd probably get some advice from someone like yourself.
Oh, good. That's the right answer, I reckon. Okay, so steroids is certainly quite a reasonable option. The problem with giving people steroids in a way is that later on they tend to try and self-medicate with their steroids. If they come to us early enough, we often will give them intramuscular steroid. So if she didn't have just one single swollen joint, we'd give her intramuscular depomedrol, so methylprednisolone, say 120. She doesn't then have control of, you know, what she's taking in. We actually control it. And that can last, you know, 6 weeks or more. So there's definitely, after a day or two, you know, all the joints sometimes melt away with that sort of treatment. So that's what we tend to prefer. But, you know, in the first instance...
Do you give the depomedrol?
Well, the least, you know, often as possible. So at the beginning, when they're obviously struggling, we will give them one. If 6 weeks later and they're back and we've started them on, you know, a disease-modifying therapy and they're still not good because it's not working yet, you could give them another one. So I wouldn't probably give them...
Second one, like a week later or 10 days later?
So I wouldn't give it to them a week or 10 days later. So you could give it again maybe 6 weeks down the track. I wouldn't be giving it...
6 weeks.
Yeah, 6 weeks, yeah. I mean, obviously, the other option is anti-inflammatories. You know, that's quite reasonable while you're waiting for someone to be seen. And, you know, aspirating and injecting the knee with steroid would be quite useful given that that is her main complaint. What's my preference for NSAIDs? Well, my personal preference is none, but because of the increased risk of cardiovascular disease and cerebrovascular disease, and you've already got double the risk with rheumatoid anyway, even without the anti-inflammatory. So if I had to choose one, I'd probably choose naproxen, really because there may be some cardiovascular benefit rather than cardiovascular side effects with it. But otherwise, everything else, including COX-2s and that, all have that increased risk of cardiovascular and cerebrovascular issues. So short-term wise, you know, 1 or 2 weeks of it, I don't mind. But as I said, my personal preference is naproxen for the reason of, you know, cardiovascular safety. And, you know, a slow release version of it. So, that's certainly not ideal. What we really want to do is do that initially, but get them off it as quickly as possible.
And are you happy with GPs starting things like Plaquenil or...?
I would be. They're happy with the diagnosis. So if we're saying, okay, this is CCP-positive rheumatoid, while they're waiting to come and see us, it would be reasonable if you're comfortable to start Plaquenil because we use it as, in early rheumatoid, if it's mild, we use it as part of combination therapy in rheumatoid as well with methotrexate and cilazapyrin. So I think it's quite reasonable to do.
Yep.
Do people start Plaquenil?
Unusual.
What about you, Graham, when you were quite remote? Did you ever... you know, sort of use methotrexate or those sort of more heavy stuff because you had to?
Well, look, we
Yeah. So we had a hotline at Royal Town Hospital and would speak to the rheumatologist quite regularly, so it was a bit easier to come back.
I guess the important thing is with the disease-modifying therapy to know what to monitor for in terms of side effects and the regular blood tests. So if you're going to start them, obviously being for the patient to be aware of what to monitor for as well. So it's quite good information sheets on the Australian Rheumatology Association website. There's patient information on pretty much everything you can put them on. And it's all ARA endorsed. So it's www.rheumatology.org. I think there's a .au at the end of it. But that's sort of something that patients can have information sheets from anyway. But if there's no other questions now, I might just sort of do a bit of a brief chat about rheumatoid arthritis. So we know that it affects about 1% of the population in Australia. Generally, the typical presentation is a symmetrical polyarthritis of the hands and feet. It affects more females, double that of males. And the main important thing is early diagnosis and early treatment to prevent joint damage. Generally, the cause is really unknown, but there are genetic and environmental factors. So obviously, if you have a first-degree relative, up to 16 times increased risk of rheumatoid arthritis. There's viral factors that can trigger rheumatoid. So parvovirus, apart from causing polyarthritis, can actually trigger rheumatoid, EBV, mycoplasma, and so on. Estrogen levels are important because we know that in pregnancy they often get better, and after they give birth, postpartum they will have a flare. Smoking we know can also trigger rheumatoid arthritis, particularly if you're CCP positive. And vitamin D deficiency we were talking about before also may have a quite important role to play in rheumatoid arthritis as well. So usually it's an insidious onset. And often it's the small joints with pain, stiffness and swelling. Often they'll have an hour or more of morning stiffness and nighttime pain that's waking them up. We don't usually see people with rheumatoid nodules and deformities these days because we get onto them a lot earlier. But they can present quite unwell, lose weight or have fatigue, even fever. So they can present like they've got a malignancy initially, but those symptoms tend to get better as you're treating the rheumatoid. I don't know who can see the pictures at the moment, but there's a picture of MCP joint that's swollen. And then there's a picture of disease progression from 2 months where the joints are generally quite swollen to 4 months when we've sort of it's gone away. This is without treatment, and then long-term disease where you can get deformities. So another picture of deformities you can see in rheumatoid arthritis. And then some, do you know, does anyone actually see these pictures?
Yeah, I can.
Yep. So what do you think these are? They're an elbow.
Oh, gosh, I used to know the name for them, I reckon. Like toe fire or something like that.
They could be, but they're not particularly yellow. But since we've called it rheumatoid arthritis, we'll probably call them rheumatoid nodules.
It's always easy ones that trip you up, Graham.
Okay, so rheumatoid factor we know is present in up to 80% of cases, so 20% or more can be seronegative. The anti-CCP antibody that we mentioned is quite specific, but we don't find it in as many patients. So maybe 50 to 70% of patients can have CCP. We do routine blood tests, of course, including full blood counts, biochemistry and inflammatory markers. We do still do x-ray of the hands and feet, and then we have mentioned ultrasound and also MRI. MRI is really more from a research point of view with rheumatoid arthritis. Again, more pictures, so some of you might be able to see these, so showing sort of periarticular osteopenia. And same thing on this one as well. And then there's two pictures, two x-rays, one that's fairly normal, and then the one on the right showing some disease progression with the arrow signs. So you can see what almost looks a bit like an apple core at the fifth finger, at the metacarpal head. So we've got sort of fairly rapidly progressive erosions. And then what we want to prevent is the next picture, which actually has MCP joint replacements, which we hopefully don't have to do these days. And if you can see the ultrasound, it shows a metacarpal head. It's got a little red dot inside it, which is power Doppler. So it shows that it's actively eroding the joint. But on the same x-ray, there actually isn't any erosive changes at the same exact MCP2 joint. So this is what we're talking about before with early diagnosis with ultrasound. We've mentioned a couple of the differentials for polyarthritis, including rheumatoid, psoriatic arthritis, lupus in a young lady, crystal arthritises, even inflammatory osteoarthritis in the older person, all the viruses we've mentioned, reactive arthritis, which we might talk about later, and migratory arthritis. Again, we've got another picture, which is of a lady with a malar rash, typical of lupus. And I guess for those who can see the screen, I haven't put the answers to these, but does anyone know what these pictures are? So the first one on the left is one thing, and the second two are the same thing. Yeah, it does a bit. One of them looks like, fungal ringworm or something, doesn't it? Can anyone else see this, or have we only got one person that can see the pictures?
Is that psoriasis?
Yeah, it looks a bit like psoriasis, doesn't it? Particularly the one in the, in fact, the one in the middle. But so the one on the left, let me give you the answers. There we go. So the one on the left is discoid lupus. That's the one that can actually scar. So it's sort of quite red, it's raised, it can atrophy. And then we've got subacute cutaneous lupus. So one is psoriform, so it looks like psoriasis. And the one that kind of looks a bit like fungus or ringworm or something is actually an annular polycyclic subacute cutaneous lupus. So these are sort of all forms of lupus rash that you might see.
And they're very characteristic patterns. I mean, it's obviously on a chest. That's
yeah, so often they're on chest. They can be on the face and that as well.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes they'll be more on sun-exposed areas as well. Yeah. Okay, and sorry, back to that one. So the SCLE may well be a drug-induced lupus as well, but we won't talk about it tonight because we have time. Complications of rheumatoid we hopefully don't see these days. So extra-articular manifestations, particularly if you're rheumatoid factor positive. So things like interstitial lung disease or pericardial pleural effusions, Filty syndrome, I think I've seen one in my entire career, cutaneous vasculitis, and then inflammatory eye problems. So we very rarely see any of these things. What are the sort of poor prognostic factors in rheumatoid? So if you're female and older, which is the typical group that actually gets rheumatoid, if you've got a high level of rheumatoid factor, a positive CCP that we mentioned, or a very high CRP, if you've got lots of tender and lots of swollen joints, if you already have erosions, if you don't function well, if you've got particular genetic markers like HLA-DR4, and if you've got poor socio-demographic status. So onto management of rheumatoid. So there's obviously non-drug therapy, things like physio, occupational therapy, hand therapy, exercises, and Arthritis Australia for education. They've got support groups as well. And then initially, so simple analgesics, paracetamol, anti-inflammatories, and then early referral to a rheumatologist to start disease-modifying drugs. So we know that they used to be called SARDs, or slow-acting anti-rheumatic drugs, which took sort of weeks to months to work. And we prefer to use combination therapy, so often with methotrexate, sulfasalazine, and plaquenil, we sort of call that triple therapy. You will see other rheumatologists using methotrexate by itself, perhaps with some prednisolone, or methotrexate with Arava. And there's reasons that we do combination therapy really in the first 6 months. If it doesn't settle, we then go into biologic therapy. There's Medicare requirements for what we need to have done by that time.
Mm. So just for my interest, you might cover it in the next slide, but if, let's say, we suspect it and if they respond pretty well to anti-inflammatories and are very asymptomatic at that point, do you still want to see them?
Absolutely, yeah, because they'll have to come off their anti-inflammatories. They might be one of those lucky ones where they sort of get a bit and it just completely goes away, sort of enters remission of its own accord, but at some stage it's going to come back. So we do have people who present and, you know, they were really bad and they've got to us and they're actually not so bad.
Mm.
But, you know, if they've got poor prognostic factors like CCP and that, we will definitely keep them and we will start them to try and protect them from developing erosions.
Sure. And this might is a question about anti-inflammatory use. It was a sports physician, I think, who told me, and this is anecdotal because he said rather than pointing to any papers, but let's say you're on a once-a-day anti-inflammatory, is there any evidence that, say, if you have a couple of rest days from those long-acting anti-inflammatories that your rate of side effects of those go right down? I mean, obviously not eliminated, but it's a lot safer.
I would tend to probably agree with that. I don't know if there's much evidence, but we know that chronic use is the issue. Mm. So if you're able to, you know, come on and off it in that way, then it'd probably be a better option while you're, you know, waiting to see someone. Sometimes people can't. As soon as they miss a dose or skip a day, it's quite bad for them.
Right.
So if they can't mobilise or, you know, do their job, they'll just keep taking it pretty much. And that's what most of our patients will do.
Okay. Even if they're on methotrexate, what's the...
So the idea of being on the disease-modifying therapies is that you can basically taper down and stop your anti-inflammatories and your steroids. So if you're successfully treating someone, they don't need those other things.
But this lady came to you playing tennis. Mm. Never diagnosed with rheumatoid arthritis.
Mm.
How much longer will we expect her to be playing tennis? You mentioned having physiotherapists involved to help with
her knee,
medical management of joints. But then, you know, my knowledge of seeing people with quite severe rheumatoid arthritis well down the track, sitting in trouble opening bottles and cans and things. So we need to probably at some stage down the track look at involving occupational therapists.
Sure, yeah.
That also means making some modifications to living accommodation.
Yep. I mean, I think before we do that, we need to see how much better we can get her. We've got this lady in her mid-70s who is actively playing tennis, and she couldn't play tennis. And after we've treated her, she was back to her social, you know, tennis quite easily. So, I mean, I think when you first present, you're obviously at your worst, and what we aim to do is to be able to get people back to their usual functional state. We don't always manage that, but most of the time, you know, they do get pretty close to, you know, back to normal. There is going to be work disability in that as well as a result of having rheumatoid, and it depends how severe your disease is. But you're quite right. I mean, we've mentioned occupational therapy as one of the things to do, so you may need modifications, and that's why getting a bit of education from Arthritis Australia and having some help with your, you know, ADLs is all quite useful.
And also, I've got a long-term steroid, so that runs in the other sort of endocrine problem with sugars and blood sugar.
So we don't want her on long-term steroids. That's the last thing we want. So, you know, if she was put on to, say, 50 of oral pred and reducing dose, she'd be rapidly tapering that with us whilst her disease-modifying therapies were starting to work. So, yeah, we wouldn't hopefully have them on long-term steroids. I mean, the approach is different for different rheumatologists. Some still do use, say, 10 or 15 regular daily prednisolone with the methotrexate. But I guess, you know, I don't personally believe in that approach because of the, you know, you're definitely going to get side effects with, you know, moderate dose prednisolone in the long term. It's not whether you're unlucky or not, you are going to get something.
Very good. Well, I'll keep pushing on, Ian, okay. So you get through it.
Yep. So really just further management. So steroids in the short term, we mentioned about Plaquenil early on, just if you have mild disease, but really, you know, if she's CCP positive, she's probably looking at using methotrexate. We mentioned biologic agents as well, like TNF blockers, such as things like Enbrel or Humira that you might have seen. And a lot of these are either intravenous or mostly subcutaneous. But, I mean, the overall summary, I suppose, of rheumatoid management is really sort of early referral and early diagnosis. There is this window of opportunity that people have shown in the first 6 months where if you can get onto it and get them to a good level, then you can change the trajectory of their disease in that time. The disease-modifying agents work better, the disease is more responsive. And after that, it seems that it'll be more chronic and more difficult to treat. So getting them there early is actually quite important. So we have the early arthritis clinic at the Royal Adelaide, and what we do try and do is, you know, get people seen in a couple of weeks, so it's not sort of months or years waiting. You do a referral in that they get seen fairly shortly. So that is quite useful as well. We treat to target, so we aim for remission, but if we can't get there, we use low disease activity. And we do that using inflammatory markers and, you know, tender and swollen joints in that clinically. We frequently assess our patients, you know, over weeks rather than months, so, you know, every 3 to 6 weeks. But, you know, at the end of the day, there may be up to half the people who have been diagnosed with rheumatoid who are not working after 5 years of disease. So there is, you know, still quite a lot of work disability.
And do the CCP levels change?
It's a good question. Sometimes some people completely do not change, even though they're in remission. Mm. There's different levels of remission, so you can get immunological remission where your CCP becomes negative, and that's sort of really deep remission. Mm. So you've got nothing clinically, you've got nothing on ultrasound or MRI, and you've got nothing immunologically. So they become CCP, rheumatoid factor negative.
Mm.
We don't often see that, unfortunately. Okay. Yeah. Might just skip that one. We still talked about disease progression as well. So we know that x-rays are fairly insensitive early on to diagnose rheumatoid, so obviously ultrasound or MRI can be quite useful in that setting.
And around Adelaide, are there particular people you like to do those scans? Or?
In terms of ultrasound?
Yeah.
At the moment, there's not a lot of us doing the ultrasounds. I've done them for probably about 10 years or more and just training up people at the moment, so training up rheumatologists around Australia to be able to do these ultrasounds.
So they tend not to be a radiologist who does them?
It's difficult because the information that we want is hard for them to give us.
Right.
We want to know how much synovitis there is, how much power Doppler. And if you send someone to say, ultrasound hands, please, I don't quite think they know where to start because it'd be rather like, could you please ultrasound this third finger? So perhaps, you know, when I was on leave and I wasn't doing them for a little while, with kids and that, people were starting to send them to radiologists and they absolutely hated doing it and were quite happy to not continue doing them.
Right.
Because it took a lot of their time because they weren't really sure which joints to look at, what you could screen and so on. So
I guess because coming out of this talk, then we're not going to be referring to radiologists to ask for signs of early erosion. Yeah.
I mean, you could potentially refer for an MRI, say a dominant hand, MCP 2 to 5 and a wrist. But it's still, you know, more at a research level. Okay. So I think we'll skip that as well. I mean, there's lots of studies. This is a COBRA study, which do show if you use combination therapy, so methotrexate, sulfasalazine, and it was actually prednisolone back in this one, it works a lot better than just a monotherapy. And the amount of benefit you have on reducing joint damage actually is carried over right up to about 5 years after the start. So once you do good at the beginning, those gains, you actually continue to gain over 5 years. Again, if you can't see this, it's probably not also useful, but I've just listed a whole heap of biologic disease modifying therapy that are available as of 2015. So on the left, you've got all the TNF blockers. So you've got Enbrel, Remicade, Humira, Simponi and Cimzia. Then you've got rituximab, which is your B-cell blocker and or B-cell depleter, and abatacept, which is your co-stimulatory blockade, so blocking sort of activation of T-cells. Then you've got tocilizumab or Actemra, which is an IL-6 inhibitor. And the very newest one is your JAK or JAK, which you will probably see in the next couple of months. It's been TGA approved and PBAC recommended for PBS listing. So it's the first oral biologic. So it's called tofacitinib or Xeljanz. So it'll be a twice a day oral drug that people will be on for a biologic therapy for rheumatoid. So I might just quickly mention what that is. So biologic DMARDs are genetically engineered. They're not chemically synthesised, and they're very targeted therapy, so anti-sort of pro-inflammatory cytokines like TNF and IL-6 and so on. And then they obviously they work to prevent joint damage. There are a whole heap of criteria which I can let you read later as to what we need to do to get someone onto a biologic DMARD, but it essentially involves 6 months of treating them. And certain inflammatory markers. Because these agents can cause reactivation of TB, we need to do a chest X-ray and a MAN2 test and even treat them with isoniazid for at least a month before we start if they've got a positive test. We screen everybody for hepatitis B, C and HIV, really more relevant for using these things so you don't reactivate particularly hep B. If they've got chronic infection, we tend to not put them on the biologic DMARDs. If they've got, you know, bad heart failure or any malignancy in the last 5 or 10 years, we do not use these ones either. Because as the name suggests, you know, tumour necrosis factor, if you inhibit it, you may well you know, trigger off malignancy again. And there is an increased risk of skin cancers with biologics. So we know that, particularly in Australia, that's quite important. And we'd like to update vaccinations like flu vax and pneumovax before we start these things. The next graph, again, if you can't see it, it's not that helpful, but you can either have a primary lack of response or you can respond a little bit. You can respond really well and have secondary failure, or you can not respond because of side effects. Certainly not everybody needs biologics, and that's why we do our triple therapy approach. And we know that in the UK, half of the people that got referred to a biologic clinic didn't actually require a biologic after their other non-biologic DMARDs were optimised. Just a bit of a cost comparison, TNF blockers cost around $20,000 to $25,000 a year, compared to, say, methotrexate, it costs about $94 a year, And, you know, even plaquenil, $260 a year. So there's a huge amount of difference in cost. And so some of these, you know, certainly not viable in the third world countries to use. And, you know, so the triple therapy is still obviously quite cost effective. I think we've gone through that.
Are any of these on the PDS or labels used in from the tertiary hospitals?
Okay, yeah, so all the biologics need to be prescribed by a rheumatologist.
What about ongoing?
Yeah, ongoing rheumatologist. Mm. Yeah, yeah. So you'll see people on them, on sort of Enbrel and Remicade and things like that. And basically all you're needing to do is monitor them for side effects. They will see their rheumatologist every 6 months to have a new script done. So only immunologist, rheumatologist, gastroenterologist, dermatologist, depending on what the problem is. Yeah.
And if they, so they're going back out to the country or, you know, what are some things that GPs have to monitor? So you said heart failures and issues, skin cancers.
Yep. Infections, definitely. So any weird and wonderful bacterial, viral, fungal, parasitic, anything can happen.
Yep.
So that's really important to know. In some of these patients, they can develop an ANA, and in fact, some of them can develop lupus. So you've obviously got to watch out for that if they develop sort of, you know, new rashes or joint pains and so on. So reactivation of TB, which is, you know, usually unlikely if you've screened them in the first place. But yeah, those sorts of things.
So if someone, let's say, presents to a country hospital with cellulitis, would you take them off their biologic DMARDs until that's treated?
Yeah, I think anything that you need, particularly intravenous antibiotics, or, you know, if you've got quite a severe infection requiring antibiotics, you tend to hold it for that period of time, just as you do with methotrexate.
Yep. And then they can restart
it? And then they restart it after that, yeah.
At the same dose?
Yeah. We tend to have fairly fixed doses for them. Yeah, the doses don't really vary very much.
Okay.
Yeah. So the next one's just a one slide on tofacitinib or Xeljanz, which is the new oral small molecule. So it inhibits an enzyme called Janus kinase or JAK. So it's quite a new drug. It's been available overseas for a couple of years, of course. But it's got an important role in what we call signal transduction. So cytokines bind to the receptor. I'll show you probably the next slide. This probably shows it a little bit better. They work just as well as the anti-TNF agents. So 60% of people will get 20% better at least. But, you know, they do have nuisance side effects like diarrhea, nausea, headaches, respiratory tract infections and so on. But the more serious side effects are things like neutropenia, anemia, abnormal liver functions, infections and so on. And the next slide just shows a representative picture of the JAK-STAT pathway. So basically if you've got a cytokine, say you've got TNF, that binds on there, it goes through this pathway of signal transduction and transcription and eventually get an inflammatory response. So this actually blocks that signal transduction of lots of different cytokines. And that's why it also gives some side effects as well. So it will block like EPO binding, erythropoietin, it will block GCSF, so that's why you'll get low white cells and so on. Okay, so for rheumatoid, I guess what we want to do in the future is to look for biomarkers that might predict how one person will respond to a particular therapy and whether they'll get side effects and whether that will be the right treatment for them, so to individualise therapy. We're talking about induction therapy, much like in cancer therapy, where you sort of give, you know, high dose up front. We've got a high dose methotrexate study going at the moment, 50 milligram subcutaneous methotrexate up front, 3 weeks in a row, and then on to usual triple therapy. People have tried induction therapy with biologics with some benefit. And then we'd like to know how to predict if it's an undifferentiated polyarthritis, you know, whether they will likely progress to rheumatoid or not, or whether they'll just get better. Obviously love a cure for rheumatoid. There are people working on vaccines for rheumatoid arthritis through dendritic cells and that, and that might not be too far away. Maybe in the next 5 or 10 years you'll hear a little bit more about that. So that'll be quite interesting as well. So that's what I've got about rheumatoid and Casper. That's gone for quite a while, but it's got the most sort of, information.
Yeah, it's a big topic. Yeah. And probably what we'll do is we'll push on, unless Anita's sort of got specific questions or there's a burning question, fire away. But we'll bat on, so we'll try and finish around 8:30 as close as we can. And then if there are any other things, certainly people can contact me through the college or any of the websites and stuff, and I can group questions and ask Anita. Not there'll be lots, but if there's anything burning, we can certainly ask her at the end too.
Okay, so case number two, moving on. A 26-year-old man who's a footballer. He's also an apprentice carpenter. He presents with left Achilles tendonitis, and he's been stretching and stretching and still not getting better. Achilles tendonitis. Yep. He also has had for a few years low back pain and stiffness, but he thinks it's because he fell off the roof a couple of years ago when he's doing his apprentice carpenter work, and he reckons his back's just bad because he fell off the roof. But he's had physio, he's even had some pyro the last couple of years, and nothing's really helped. He just tends to always have low back pain and stiffness. And then there's a picture of possibly him sort of rubbing his sacroiliac joint, a bit sore there.
He's pointing at it.
He's actually pointing at it. It's pretty useful.
Mm.
Okay, so same thing. Any questions, examination findings that you'd like to know, investigations you want to order? Over to you guys. Okay. So he's... Mm-hmm. So he's got significant of course, yep. So he has prolonged morning stiffness. He tends to wake at night time with a bit of this sacroiliac low back pain, and it tends to go into his buttocks as well. Yes, bilateral, yes. Even though he just pointed to his left side, he actually does have bilateral.
Get any bowel symptoms or STD complaints or rashes?
Not recently, or not that he's admitting to.
Yeah. And how long is he stiff for in the morning?
I stiff for a couple of hours in the morning, yeah. Let me see how long. Yeah, 1 to 2 hours. Then
okay, so that's pretty significant.
He's tried some Voltaren for the back pain, and that tends to help. But he does wake up early morning hours, so 4 a.m. in the morning he's often up with pain going into his butt from his lower back. He also volunteers that his dad had a bad back for a number of years, but he's never been investigated.
Hmm.
Any other questions, if you can't see the slides, any other things you want to know?
Well, I guess any neck problems, and also since you did fall off the roof, was reading injuries noted at the time of his...
Yep. So I think he had x-rays at the time and he didn't fracture anything, didn't really have any sort of obvious changes on his x-rays at that time. This was a couple of years ago. He's just to volunteer some more information. He hasn't had any other inflammatory eye or bowel symptoms either, no other recent infections.
So I know we've got a rheumatologist talking to us, which is always a giveaway, but from a sports medicine or musculoskeletal point of view, what do you think some of the anatomical structures that could also sort of cause pain in that area? So facet joints or, small disc protrusion? What do you reckon? Yeah, there's all sorts of, I quite like that discussion about somatic, versus radicular type pain. And, I think there's a recent article in Australian Family Physician or something that was talking about just remembering that true sciatic pain sort of below the knee. And I've certainly seen radiating pain down to the knee from, glute medius tendinopathies and SI joint pains and stuff. So just quite localised pain doesn't need to be localised, I guess. But, we'll push on.
Yep. Say that again, sorry?
Being a footballer, he had any trouble on the football field? His performance from the game changed at all.
Oh, okay. Well, it's not so good because he's got this Achilles tendon that's hurting him. So I haven't really given him an actual exact. Yeah, he's just a footballer generally, but. Yeah, I mean, if he was sort of playing professionally, I suppose he's not been playing quite so well recently because of this this back stiffness and pain.
Well, the interesting point, he's talking about Achilles pain. Is that actually some sort of referred pain that he's not interpreting You know, so I guess you're right. You got to sort of explore, and then particularly if it's discogenic, you know, sort of as he's bending forward to pick the ball up or kicking through the ball, you know, he's getting into a straight leg raise or a neural stretch effectively, and if that's causing issues, then, you know, I guess you're sort of thinking mechanical a little bit. But thankfully, we've got a rheumatologist, so we don't need to think along those lines.
Well, I suppose if you're thinking mechanical, we shouldn't sort of really be waking up in the middle of the night with it.
Yeah.
Yeah. So just inflammatory versus mechanical back pain. But so we like to examine him now, and his left Achilles tendon, where it inserts onto the calcaneum, is actually quite tender and swollen. He also has a bit of tenderness at the right plantar fascial insertion as well, which he wasn't particularly aware of himself. We do a modified Schober's test, so we get him to bend forward to touch his toes, and we measure how much that distance increases from 10 centimetres in the lower back. His increases to 14 centimetres, so it's a little bit reduced. He's got a 22 centimetre finger floor distance, so he can't touch the ground, and you'd expect he would be able to in a you know, otherwise fit young man. He also can't laterally flex very well, so he sort of only flexes around 8 centimetres both sides when he does lateral flexion of the lumbar spine. His neck actually moves quite well, so there's no issues there. There's no psoriasis to find, no psoriatic nail changes, no dactylitis either. We also investigate him. Well, actually, before we do that, what investigations do people want to do?
Graham, you get nominated if it's too quiet.
No, that's all right. I'll probably just about do the same one that was done on page one. I think it's probably quite simple. Because we're sort of thinking about inflammatory issues, you probably do the same sort of screen as we did in the first case, I thought. I would x-ray his low back, just as a plain field, I think.
Yeah.
As a starting point, anyway.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, we definitely did that. Is there any other blood test that you want to do that might be different from the first case?
We do want to do an ultrasound on you.
You could do that, definitely, and you could see if there's actually tendonitis there.
What about a HLA-B27?
Bingo.
Bingo, and I didn't see the next slide. So.
No, we didn't do it in the first one. So B27, in fact, he is positive, as it happens, just to make life a bit easier. And he's RF and CCP negative, so he's zero negative. He has normal ESR and CRP, and that's actually not uncommon in the setting of seronegative arthritis. He has radiology done, as suggested by you guys, and his lumbar spine and sacroiliac joints actually look normal on radiology. He has then progressed to have an MRI because we strongly think he might have something going on in his sacroiliac joints, and he's just got grade 1, so just a little bit of fuzziness at the sacroiliac joints bilaterally, but certainly no erosions. No fusion or anything like that. So there's something going on at both sacroiliac joints on MRI. So what's his diagnosis?
He's got ankylosing spondylitis.
So has he ankylosed?
Not yet,
but he will. So you're quite right. I mean, people would normally call this ankylosing spondylitis, but let's just call it something different. It's still AS, but let's call it axial spondyloarthritis. It's probably a bit of a term that we prefer to use because then we're not saying they actually have ankylosis. So it's really sort of the new term that, you know, people are using. So instead of saying this person has ankylosing spondylitis when they haven't ankylosed and they may not progress to ankylose, then we call it axial spondyloarthritis. So some of the different... So axial... axial spondyloarthritis, yeah. So then in this group of, you know, seronegative arthritis, we always think of, you know, psoriatic, but he didn't actually have psoriasis, so it makes it less likely. We also think of reactive arthritis, but he doesn't give a clear history of any STDs or gastro or any other infections before this happened. Enteropathic, so inflammatory bowel-related, Crohn's or osteocolitis, but he hasn't got any inflammatory bowel symptoms, although they may be subclinical, but he hasn't got them. So all those other diagnoses are probably less likely, so still looking more like a, you know, the previous, what we would have called anxbond type of diagnosis.
So do those reactive and enteropathic, do they cause more axial inflammation than peripheral, or is it very...
It can vary. Mm. Yeah, I will be talking about one of those two later, and we can talk about where that happens. So what do people want to do with this chappy?
Sharon, if you're on the line, you haven't said anything? She might be busy. Oh, just trying to provoke a little bit of discussion, but I'd probably go for some anti-inflammatories and a range of movement sort of therapies to get his back moving as an initial trial.
That's good.
Would you again use some steroids here to get him settled?
You could. Again, would you give it orally to him, or would you give it into his sacroiliac joint, or would you give it around his Achilles tendon?
Oh, I wouldn't take anything into his sacroiliac
joint. So you wouldn't?
I wouldn't.
Oh, okay. Not personally, you mean?
Again, there's some sports physicians who are quite feel okay about injecting the SI joint in their rooms under, you know, not imaging. I've had another sports physician when I'm helping GWS Giants. He tried to inject the sacroiliac joint and gave him a sciatic nerve block. So that put me off personally. So, but the musculoskeletal pain guys are quite keen on injecting SI joints, you know, particularly with obviously local with the cortisone, and to see whether there's any acute change in the pain, and that could be quite helpful to try and, I think, differentiate it from a low, you know, L5, S1 facet joint or anything else that might be causing sort of low pain like that. So I've got a pretty low threshold if I think it's SI joint to inject them personally.
Yeah. I mean, I would get them to have it under CT guidance, the sacroiliac joints. Given that we've done the MRI on this guy because of our level of suspicion and he's got some sacroiliitis, he may well respond quite well to that. So I think it's definitely worth a go with some steroid into the SI joints, and definitely physiotherapy, back exercises, mobility. You know, the other thing would be sulfasalazine or salazoparine if he had more peripheral joint involvement, which he doesn't really at this stage. So I wouldn't start that at this stage. So anti-inflammatories, obviously, that may help the Achilles, or you might need to think about injecting around the paratenon of the Achilles. And really the only thing that is definitely, apart from anti-inflammatories, the only other thing that's definitely helpful for the back would be TNF inhibitors. So it's a fairly big step up if you're going from anti-inflammatories to TNF inhibitors. But methotrexate doesn't help. Sulfasalazine might, but generally not.
And again, naproxen once a day is a
favourite. Sometimes you'll find in these sorts of cases, you might need to do a little bit stronger, like sort of the Voltaren Indica type thing, and that's quite reasonable to control these in the short term. But it's not a long-term solution. Any... Okay, so if we're talking about ankylosing spondylitis, because that's where the research has been done, 90% will be B27 positive, so the majority. So you can still have it and be B27 negative. So these days there's sort of two groups. You can be B27 positive and not have the x-ray findings, but have a whole heap of other things that might go with it, like your endocytosis, dactylitis, inflammatory bowel, uveitis, etc. So if you have enough of those other things and you're B27 positive and there's non-radiographic changes, so no radiographic changes, you can still diagnose it. If you're not B27 positive but you have the radiographic changes and you've got a couple of other features, then you can also diagnose it as well. Keeping in mind that 10% of the Australian population will be B27 positive anyway, and they don't necessarily have arthritis. So it's useful, but it's not the only test you're going to do in ANCSPOND, because there's obviously other genes involved as well. It's just that we don't currently test for them. So, you know, that's the issue. It's always been about B27, but it's not really. There's, you know, certainly more. Again, we won't have time to discuss all that, but there are other new genes that people do test for. You know, IL-23 receptors and ERAPs and all this sort of stuff. But they are not so useful at this stage because, you know, we don't routinely test for them. But if you're B27 negative, you may be positive for one of those other genetic markers.
So there's minor and major criteria, that sort of thing, or
Kind of, yes, yeah. So it's either you have the radiographic criteria for sacroiliitis or you don't, and then you have the B27 and you don't have the x-rays.
Right.
Yeah. I think I might have something about that, one of the slides. Okay, so inflammatory versus mechanical back pain we kind of talked about. So the longer you have morning stiffness for, the more inflammatory it sounds rather than mechanical. If you're waking up second half of the night, so early morning hours, you know, e.g. 4 o'clock in the morning, it's more inflammatory rather than mechanical. Obviously, if you move around and it gets better versus getting worse with mechanical. Alternating buttock pain is a fairly specific sign as well for sacroiliac joint pain and a good response to anti-inflammatories as well. So this whole group of what we call SPA, or big S, little p, big A, seronegative spondyloarthritis, they generally are RF negative and B27 positive usually. And this is that group that we've mentioned with the psoriatic arthritis, ANCSBON, reactive arthritis, and inflammatory bowel related. So you can have spinal involvement and peripheral joints as well. The very typical one to make you think about it is this asymmetrical oligoarthritis, especially in the lower limb, so a hip here, a knee there, an ankle, and also enthesitis, particularly Achilles tendon and plantar fascial involvement. And you can also obviously get extra-articular features, you know, like uveitis or iritis affecting the eyes. You can get aortic regurgitation with the heart, with aortitis, and gastrointestinal features as well of inflammatory bowel. Here we have an ultrasound. Someone mentioned ultrasound of the Achilles. And again, you might not be able to see the picture, but it goes from looking normal to very big and more fuzzy, so it's not very well-defined tendon fibres for Achilles tendonitis, and it can light up with power Doppler as well. Plantar fasciitis, sorry.
What's the pathophysiology of the aortic regurgitation?
I think it's thought to be the aortic valve and the aortic root actually gets inflamed and you develop aortic regurgitation.
So they dilate, obviously.
So the aortic root dilates.
Yeah, I think that's what they think is happening. It's certainly something they sometimes see in reactive arthritis as well, and that's what they think happens in reactive arthritis. Okay, so again, we're going to call it ANCSBON because really that's where the research is. And mainly it affects males, as you all know. We have persistent buttock and sacroiliac joint pain, spinal inflammatory pain, chest and interscapular pain. Can have, you know, inflammatory eye disease up in up to a third of patients with ANCSBON and significant morning stiffness, you know, often lasting a couple of hours. If they're not treated, obviously they can get obvious deformity of the spine, thoracic kyphosis, loss of lumbar lordosis. It's very interesting that the delay in diagnosis, particularly because it's young men who are diagnosed with this, around 8 years. So a lot of people will attribute it, like this guy might have, to having fallen off the roof, and I've just got back pain, I'm just going to always have it. And often they won't present to the GP until something else happens apart from that back.
So 8 years down the track, what do you think is the giveaway, or what changes it such that that diagnosis is made rather than missed at that time?
Well, I think the patient presents at that time.
Okay.
So it may well be that they're getting more stiff or having more pain or having something else that's happened, so whether it's enthesitis or dactylitis or a joint has swollen up. And by the way, you know, I've had this back being a bit, you know, a bit dicky for about, you know, 7 or 8 years.
Yeah, any evidence, any research on how often they would present to a GP before that diagnosis is made?
I don't know about that.
So it's more about a new symptom that sort of brings them to the GP.
Yeah. Okay. So I don't know, is this going to be interesting? Test? Okay. So obviously you're going to do range of movements of your cervical, lumbar and thoracic spine, and those tests that I suggested, like the modified Schober's test, looking for the amount of lumbar spine forward flexion, finger floor distance. We can do an occiput to wall distance, so between, you know, behind the back of your head to the wall. So if you have decreased cervical spine extension, you'll have more than 0 centimetres from the wall, so they can't put the head back against the wall. I also measure chest expansion as well. There is a different range for different ages and sex. So obviously males actually have, you know, normally have larger chest expansion, and the younger you are, the larger your chest expansion should be as well. So if you're having a chest expansion of 5 centimetres and you're 21, then it's pretty abnormal. If you're a little old lady, you've got 5 centimetres, that's pretty excellent. So it really depends. And x-rays can show, if it's more advanced, squaring of the vertebrae, a bamboo spine, erosions in the sacroiliac joint, or even fusion. So I've got examples where the sacroiliac joints here are completely fused, so you can't actually see them, they're just white. And here's the example of a bamboo spine. So this is when, so you can see the syndesmophytes joining between the vertebrae.
Is that usually best seen on lateral or AP or?
I think you can definitely see them on the AP and you can see them on the lateral as well. So I don't think it's
a
preference really. Yeah, kind of looks bamboo-y both ways.
Mm.
This is what I was talking about before with the classification criteria, how there's sort of these two groups, either imaging positive or B27 positive. If they're B27 positive and they don't have the imaging, they now call them non-radiographic axial spondyloarthropathy. So it's a whole big new group. And that's that sort of new, early, previously called ANCSPOND, which is now axial spondyloarthritis that they're trying to target with early TNS so they don't end up being ANCSPOND. So that's where the research is going into as well. But the other features that we look at with spondyloarthropathy are the, you know, the heel-enthesitis, uveitis, dactylitis, psoriasis, inflammatory bowel, good response to NSAIDs, a family history of spondyloarthropathy, B27 and raised CRP. So that's all listed on the slides anyway for you to have a read through. And this was in groups of people who had chronic back pain over 3 months and they were under the age of 45. Okay, so we want to identify early. NSAIDs are the first line of treatment. If you've got peripheral disease, then maybe some methotrexate or sulfasalazine, but the only real thing that helps with the spinal disease is TNF blockers. Mm. And so, you know, the ANCSPOND patients that we have, you know, pretty much all of them would be on TNF blockers if they qualify for them. And the physio, hydrotherapy, exercises, and obviously avoiding complications as well.
So by exercises, what sort of exercises?
Sort of range of motion exercises, back strengthening exercises. Sometimes we'll, you know, do Pilates and that kind of thing. Or sleeping on a bed which is quite supportive, as flat as possible. So one pillow, not more than that, so you don't get sort of decreased cervical extension. Right. Yeah. And now, so one slide on what's new. There's quite a lot of what's new, but none of it's actually approved in Australia. So again, you can read it, but anti-IL-12/23 is called ustekinumab. It's known as Stelara, so you've probably seen that around for psoriasis patients. So that's been approved for quite a while for psoriasis, in the process of looking for ANCSPOND for that. There's something called secukinumab. It's anti-IL-17. It works in ANCSPOND, but it worsens inflammatory bowel. So if you happen to have that, you can't really use it. Mm. Apremilast, which is a PDE4 inhibitor, is something that is being considered at the moment, in fact, for psoriatic arthritis. And again, it's an oral biologic. So you might hear more about apremilast. I think it's called Otelza. And tofacitinib, or the JAK inhibitor that we mentioned, they are trialling at the moment in ANCSPOND, but there's no conclusive results with that yet.
Mm.
So this is all the new sort of biologics in the different groups, not just TNF. So, okay.
Very good. Oh, we'll 15, push on. Yeah, yeah, about another 15 to go.
Okay, because the very last case is very, very quick. Excellent. So, case number 3, 35-year-old lady who's a netballer. She's got a painful left hip for a couple of weeks. She's had a bit of physio, hasn't really helped. Even resting from netball hasn't really helped. She mentions that her knees are a bit stiff, but they're not swollen. Her brother has psoriatic arthritis, and she basically comes to you because she's worried she might have psoriatic arthritis. Having said that, she doesn't have psoriasis herself. So what does she have?
One thing I usually try and understand from patients is what they mean by hip pain, you know.
Yep.
So is it posterior, lateral, groin, or anterior to your pain?
So this lady definitely has left anterior groin true hip joint pain. So it's not a trochanteric bursitis, it's not her back, it's not her SI joint. It's definite hip pain.
Yep. And is that knee stiffness, which we can see on the slide, is that early morning or through the day with exercise? Or?
Yeah, so she's noticed it's particularly early morning stiffness in the knees. But she hasn't sort of, you know, thought too much about it because it doesn't limit her later on, and they're not really painful, they're not swollen. Does it matter that she doesn't have psoriasis? Could she have psoriatic arthritis, or pretty much rules it out? What do people think?
Graham? No. Any ideas? I'd like to see some psoriasis. I saw once an ankle psoriasis person with just a patch behind their ear, which is very hard to find. So no personal history of psoriasis doesn't get you out of doing a pretty good examination.
I agree. Definitely. Okay. So she then volunteers a history that she's had dandruff in her hair for many years. And her lower back often does ache as well. And so she's stiff in her back, her left hip and her knees for 2 hours in the morning. She started some fish oil, but it's not really helping. So we examine her, and her Faber test, her flexion abduction external rotation test of her left hip, it's painful, it's limited. She actually does have an effusion at the left knee. She has dactylitis, so sort of sausage-looking toes, just two of them. And she's got some flexor tenosynovitis at several fingers, although it hasn't really bothered her. Her sacroiliac joints are tender bilaterally when you stress them. And she, in fact, does have a small patch of psoriasis in her scalp, which she thought was dandruff. And she's got a little bit in her umbilicus as well. So, and she does have any nail changes of psoriasis. Her lumbar spine moves normally. Her Schober's test is normal as well. Mm-hmm. So her forward flexion is normal.
And just while we're thinking about it, I was saying on YouTube there's some quite good examples of Schober's and modified Schober's too. You know, you can find a lot of those examinations on YouTube. A particularly good series is at British Journal of Sports Medicine. I've got some quite comprehensive YouTube videos, but again, I might get off Anita if there's any favourites she's got too.
Yeah, well, I pretty much just tell people what it's actually done when you mark them, so a posterior cerebral spine.
Mm-hmm.
If you're doing modified, you just do 10 centimetres above that in the midline, and then you basically get them to bend forwards and see how much it increases.
Oh.
If it's not modified, you do 5 centimetres below that point as well, so you start at 15 and it should increase to at least over 20.
Okay.
Yeah, but then you've got to pull their pants right down.
Right.
Yeah. So we tend to do modified shoulders. Yeah. Okay. Any investigations people want to do? Yeah. Have we lost everybody?
People still on? Hello? Just in case, we'll just keep pushing on just in case people can hear us, but...
I think Sharon's gone, she's written a message there. So I'm just presuming the other people who are still on are on?
Yep.
Okay. All right, so we've examined. Her ESR and CRP are normal, which is not unlikely in these sorts of cases. She's B27 negative. Again, 50% maybe. In, for example, psoriatic arthritis, she's zero negative, which is expected as well. And her x-rays are normal. She has an ultrasound of the left hip, and she does have synovitis and effusion in the hip joint, and is power Doppler positive. She also has some trochanteric bursitis as well that they've seen on ultrasound, which is quite a common finding when you ultrasound a hip.
And that power Doppler, is that synovium that's lit up? Or?
Yeah. Yeah. So that's the lining that's lit up.
Mm.
Okay. So the diagnosis of this is probably psoriatic arthritis. And the differential being a seronegative rheumatoid, of course. But she does have these asymmetrical large joints. She has that bit of psoriasis. We found the dactylitis, and she's got that the brother with psoriatic arthritis. So ankylosing spondylitis might be another consideration, but she hasn't got sacroiliitis. Reactive arthritis, but she doesn't give a history of STDs or gastro. And enteropathic, but no inflammatory bowel symptoms. So... what we want to do is get rid of this left hip pain, so we're going to inject it under ultrasound. We recommend some physiotherapy for her back, sacroiliac joints and so on. Anti-inflammatories work quite well for the dactylitis and the enthesitis. And for those peripheral joints, so if the left hip injection didn't help, then we would try some cilaspyrin, plus or minus methotrexate. And if those things didn't work, then we go to TNF inhibitors. So just to summarise, psoriatic arthritis in a couple of slides. So 5 different patterns where there's just DRP involvement with nail involvement, and oligoarthritis affecting sort of asymmetrical lower limbs and the spine, sacroiliac joints, the symmetrical polyarthritis which looks just like rheumatoid, and then arthritis mutilans where the fingers are telescoped in, and it's quite uncommon. Often there's a family history of psoriasis or psoriatic arthritis, or a personal history of psoriasis. We know that if we treat the psoriasis, that can actually help the arthritis and vice versa. And dactylitis we also look for. They usually are seronegative, or they can get false positive rheumatoid factor in about 10% of them. And nail changes with pitting, ridging, onycholysis, hyperkeratosis. So interestingly, in psoriatic arthritis, 80% of people have nails involved. However, if you just have psoriasis, 20% of those people have nail involvement. it.
So it's a bit of a predictor or a clue anyway.
That's right, that there's something else going on, not just psoriasis. And just some pictures of, we can still hear you, but...
Yes, thanks, Graham. Okay. Thanks for letting us know. But like I said, we'll push on, obviously, with the presentation and... you know, I'll put out the recording, the audio with the slides later, but thanks for that. So if any of you are talking, we're not ignoring you on purpose anyway, so sorry about that.
I suppose with the last case, if we do get to that, if anyone wants to type anything like Graham has just done, if they want to type, that's also possible.
So,
psoriatic nail changes with the pits you can see in here particularly and the ridging. Some more sort of psoriasis pictures, nail changes, a good going dactylitis, and DIP joint involvement, which if you don't have osteoarthritis, is likely to be psoriatic arthritis.
How would you define dactylitis?
Well, dactylitis is really pretty much looks like a sausage shaped finger. It really consists of several things: of enthesitis of the collateral ligaments, of tenosynovitis, of the flexor tendons more so than extensor tendons, and also synovitis at those joints. So the MCP, PRP, DRP joints.
Right.
So when you do ultrasounds, it's a combination of all of those things.
So all the joints involve MCP.
Yeah, PIP, so PIP. Usually, or at least the PIP, DIP to give that sausage shape.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely the DIP has to be involved as well, to look sausagey, and often they're quite hot on ultrasound in terms of power Doppler.
Mm.
Yeah. Okay, so there's another DIP joint involvement, which is, looks sort of typically psoriatic as well. And we know that, so the question was, if we have possible psoriatic arthritis with no psoriasis, most of the time, so 80% of the time, the skin rash is there before the psoriatic arthritis, and usually within the last 10 years. The arthritis can appear first in up to 20% of people before the rash of psoriasis appears.
Mm.
So some of our patients will develop the psoriasis later. And sometimes they actually appear at the same time. So new psoriasis and new psoriatic arthritis. We always look for dactylitis. A third of patients will have that. And enthesitis, especially of the Achilles tendon and the plantar fascia. And psoriasis can be hidden, as Mark mentioned. It can be around the scalp, behind the ears. Natal cleft is a one that people can't check themselves. And we always do check and do a thorough examination, including umbilicus as well. Psoriatic skin rash, a few more pictures of psoriasis. So we know that unlike rheumatoid, there's actually more flexor tenosynovitis, and in fact the extensor tendons often tend to be spared. They rarely get nodules. Unlike rheumatoid can have nodules, you would rarely have them in psoriatic arthritis. 40 or 50% are B27 positive. And raised ESR, up to about 40% versus, most of the patients with rheumatoid. Those psoriasiform lesions, you can also see if there's inflammatory bowel or reactive arthritis issues. It may not be psoriatic arthritis if you've got psoriasiform lesions. And that lupus rash we showed you guys earlier, which could be psoriasiform, can be a bit tricky as well.
Can that on skin biopsy be differentiated fairly even?
Yeah, so if you biopsy this rash, you could definitely tell if it was subcutaneous lupus or not. So sometimes we'll get skin, our dermatology friends to biopsy if we're not sure.
If you're doing it yourself, do you have to ask for anything in particular, like any stains or immunofluorescence? Or?
I know they have sort of anti-row, antibodies and stuff, but I'm not entirely sure.
You just raise the possibility on the clinical notes.
That's it. And then you would, I don't do my own skin biopsies, but the dermatologists obviously know what to ask.
Yeah, well, again, I just think of the country, our country cousins.
They do it themselves. Yeah, yeah.
You still put it in formalin and send it off as far as you know? Okay, fine.
All right. And then so imaging. So x-rays, they can get something called periostitis. So it looks a bit fluffy where those collateral ligaments attach. So it's a little bit far away from the joints, not right at the joint.
Mm.
They can certainly get ankylosis. Sacroiliitis, they can see on plain x-ray the fusiform joint swelling. So they can be a lot more swollen than rheumatoids even sometimes. And the syndesmophytes, those bony bridges we talked about as well. They can actually be quite asymmetrical as compared to axon, which tends to be more sort of symmetrical, bamboo-y looking. And we can do ultrasounds and MRIs to look at synovitis versus enthesitis, so where tendons and ligaments attach onto bone. You basically always get enthesitis with the psoriatic type arthritis and much less commonly in rheumatoid.
Mm.
So that's a helpful point. So some x-ray changes, so where the arrows are to look for the just articular periostitis, so sort of a fluffy looking appearance. A bit more fluffy where you've got some more arrows in these pictures, and then again you can see sort of they look kind of like little erosions, but they're not quite osteoarthritis, a little bit far away from the joint line. And then you can get that pencil and cup, which everyone would have learnt about in medical school.
Mm.
Or actually it kind of disappears, a gross osteolysis there. All right, it's a really bad x-ray that you're not missing. On the left of the screen, but it's pencil and cup appearance with arthritis mutilans, and then some syndesmophytes on the cervical spine x-ray. Okay, so how do we treat it? Pretty much how we treated this lady with anti-inflammatories, local steroids for the enthesitis dactylitis. If they have psoriasis with a psoriatic arthritis, we prefer methotrexate because it actually helps the skin. Arava does not work for the skin. And I've experienced that many times when I've had to change my patients from methotrexate to Arava for their joints and their skin gets worse. So methotrexate certainly helps the psoriasis. Sazepirine also works for the joints, and again TNF inhibitors if these things don't work. Newer agents, recently the TGA approved apremilast or Otelza, however the PBS have turned it down at present, so it's not going on to the PBS for a little while yet. But obviously enough evidence for it. Stelara, which is the one we mentioned that's already approved for psoriasis, the IL-12/23 inhibitor, is certainly on the cards for psoriatic arthritis as well, but not approved yet. But those are things that you might see very soon in the next year or two. Okay. And I reckon everyone can probably guess what case four is going to be because we've been preempting it all night, that we're going to get a reactive arthritis, I think. So we can probably wrap this one up in about 1 minute. So a swollen left knee in a 21-year-old basketballer. He can't recall actually injuring his knee in the game. And he's had some physio, he's braced it, he's rested it, and it's still not better. He hasn't got any fever, rash, nausea, loss of appetite to say it's a septic arthritis, so it's not systemically unwell. Does a bit of binge drinking on the weekends. Maybe he's got gout, who knows. So does anyone want to ask any questions or type any questions at this point? Or otherwise I'll keep going. I'll just wait to see if anyone's...
We'll see how fast Graham Hughes can type. one of the questions I had was how soon did that knee blow up? Was it over a day or two, or I mean, he said he came in after a game, but do you think classically it would be over 2 or 3 days?
Yeah, so over a couple of days, yeah. Okay, so I don't see anyone typing at the moment, so I'll keep going. So he does recall after a bit of prompting that about 3 weeks ago he had a bit of dysuria and a small amount of urethral discharge. I wasn't going to mention it to you initially. About 2 weeks ago, he had about a week's worth of, you know, slightly red eyes. He had a couple of late nights maybe, but he thought maybe he had a bit of conjunctivitis, but there wasn't any real discharge. He hasn't had any skin rashes or changes, no ulcers or anything like that. And he has definitely got a swollen left knee. It's not red and hot to suggest septic arthritis. We couldn't find any inflammatory changes in his eyes, so no conjunctivitis, uveitis, iritis. He doesn't have psoriasis, no enthesitis, dactylitis, and his sacral iliac joints are normal. He has some investigations as well. His ESR and CRP are moderately raised, and he is B27 positive.
So what's moderately?
Oh, we'll make it up. Okay.
Yes.
So I say he's got his ESR is 40, his CRP is 20.
Yep.
He has we send off a urine because we think he's possibly got an STD with that dysuria and urethral discharge, and he comes back positive on PCR for chlamydia. So we're just kind of, we didn't do a urethral swab. And he's negative for gonorrhea. That's important. He's had some stool cultures as well because we want to make sure, you know, this is not sort of enteric related because it could be sort of a subclinical infection and there's no bacteria we've picked up. And of course, we have to stick a needle into his knee because he's got this acutely swollen knee. Make sure there definitely is not infection and it's negative for cultures. The other big consideration is that of crystals, of course, whether it be gout or pseudogout and it's negative. It just looks like an inflammatory exudate in there. So we can't culture any bugs in the knee. It doesn't need to come back with any. So we diagnose him with post-genitourinary or post-STD reactive arthritis. This could have been post-enteric, but he hasn't had a diarrheal illness, he hasn't had positive stool cultures. It could have been a crystal arthritis, but there's been crystals on aspirate. It could be still a presentation, first presentation of a more generalised inflammatory arthritis, so it could be a first rheumatoid, first psoriatic, first James Bond. It could be a traumatic effusion if he just doesn't recall an injury, be it hemarthrosis or if he's had a, you know, other bleeding disorder. And septic arthritis, it's not systemically unwell, it's not red hot joint. So we're going to give him some NSAIDs, maybe some naproxen, favourite one for his knee pain. We've aspirated it, we will have injected it with some steroid. If it looked like it wasn't pus coming out, probably inject it at the same time.
Okay, so you're happy if it's not red and hot, can put some cortisone in it?
Yep. I would. If it's not coming out, you know, thick, pussy looking, and you're really just not concerned, the history doesn't go with it, I would inject it at the time, saves him another stab.
Yeah, one or two cortisone, like one or two ampules?
Two usually at least, and obviously you treat the chlamydia STD and all that goes with that. Generally, he should get better, and we'll go into how many sort of percent get better and how many don't. Because he's B27 positive, there is a risk of him developing axe bond later on, or some axial spondyloarthritis. And certainly if this pain does not go away, we may need to put him on something like sulazapyrine or methotrexate if this is going on for months and it's not getting better. So previously this was known as rhytis, but because he was a Nazi war criminal, it's not known as that anymore. So we have this triad of conjunctivitis, arthritis and urethritis, non-gonococcal urethritis or non-infectious. So it can be caused by chlamydia STDs in particular, or the gastrobug, Salmonella, Shigella, Yersinia, Campylobacter. It's even been caused by chlamydia pneumonia, like respiratory tract infection as well, and, you know, strep sore throats and things like that. Usually the definition is within a month of the infection. So if you have a nippy's big outbreak and they're trying to say, you know, 6 months later, I've got my arthritis, I'm going to sue them now, and that's part of the big, you know, case, then you're not going to get any money for that. So it has to be within that period of time. And the longer you have the diarrhea for and the worse you generally are, the higher likelihood you may get a reactive arthritis. It could only still be up to 5% though, that'll actually get the reactive arthritis after an enteric infection anyway. Okay, so usually they're acutely unwell, a bit of fever, muscle aches and that. And joint involvement-wise, it's usually asymmetrical oligoarthritis in the lower limbs. And half of them will have lower back pain and reduced lumbar flexion. They can have enthesitis or dactylitis, conjunctivitis or iritis. And bilateral involvement of the eyes is quite common. And this guy had some conjunctivitis but didn't really think much of it. So you can also get ulcers, you can get keratoderma blenorrhagica, which I'll show you what it looks like in a minute. And then urogenital symptoms up to 90%. And sometimes people actually just don't notice it because it can be asymptomatic. Or, you know, it might be a little bit of extra discharge for a female, a bit of frequency dysuria, they might think they've got a UTI or something else. But they can also get genital ulceration, which we know as circinate balanitis. So if you're lucky enough to have some pictures on your screen, you've got some pretty nice pictures of keratoderma blenorrhagica. We've got a geographic-looking tongue, circinate tongue lesions, and a circinate balanitis with ulcers on the penis.
Can they just have an orchitis as a presentation? Because I heard about, you know, the sore back, weepy dick sort of thing, you know, but can they just have, you know, a sore testicle or an orchitis or epididymo orchitis?
It's possible, but much less likely.
More likely urethritis.
That's right, yeah. So urethritis by definition should be part of the triad. So I think if they just said the orchitis, you know, you'd be thinking maybe something else is going on. And we do like to do the fecal samples to try and culture the bug to confirm they've actually had it. And
not just a viral? It has to be more of a bacterial.
Occasionally, viral things can give you a reactive arthritis as well, but the typical ones are the bacterial gastro bugs. You can certainly swab, you know, your urethral vaginal swabs for STDs. You can do urine PCRs, as we did already for this guy. You can do your inflammatory markers, white cell counts. So anti-streptolysin O-titer can be raised if you've got strep sore throat, so that can be useful. B27 is important to test, really, because these people, if they're B27 positive, are more likely to get sacral iliac joint involvement and uveitis, as well as going on to develop axe bond. So it's good to know and keep looking after them, rather than saying, okay, you've got better, it might actually come back. You have to exclude HIV infection because commonly you can see reactive arthritis in that setting. So you should do HIV as part of it. And they can get quite a severe psoriasiform dermatitis as part of it. X-rays can be done, sacral iliac joint MRIs, particularly because this is a young group of people, often young males. If they've got any symptoms suggestive of sacral iliac joint involvement and the plain X-rays are normal, you might find if you looked at them, you know, 5 years down the track, they will have sacral ileitis. But if you do it there and then with the MRI, 2 to 4 years ahead of the X-ray, you'll find something. And that's important to know as well, because you don't want them to fuse or damage. And obviously you're going to analyse the synovial fluid. to make sure there's nothing else going on. So antibiotics you can use for the acute infection, so for the chlamydia, for example. Very rarely do people sort of use, I guess, the antibiotics for the enteritis. But we know that for the enteritis in particular, you can't prevent reactive arthritis by giving antibiotics. There might be the ability to prevent reactive arthritis in chlamydia-induced reactive arthritis, or to lessen the course, the duration of symptoms, if you give a tetracycline. Mm. They've used something in trials called limacycline, and that seems to reduce the duration of the reactive arthritis as possible. Anti-inflammatories are mentioned, so those are powering for joints in particular. And generally, they go quite well. 2/3 of them go quite well. 1/3 of them can get chronic arthritis, particularly if they're B27 positive and sacroiliitis. And up to half of them, so 15 to 50%, can get recurrent arthritis. So either a new infection triggering another bout of reactive arthritis or some other stressor coming along.
Even psychological? Or?
Yeah, right. So they can actually come back as well. Mm. And so if you're B27 positive, up to half of those can actually develop and spond after reactive arthritis. Okay, we are done.
Well, thank you very much, Anita. That was a really good wrap-up of some common presentations for sports medicine presentations for sure. So I'd like to thank you on behalf of everyone and everyone who's going to hear this on YouTube and the interweb in the future. So thanks again, Anita. And we'll look forward to sending you
More questions
down the track. So once again,
of course, I can't hear those questions right now.
Not right now, but yeah. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thanks everyone for joining in.
Yeah. Thank you very much.